Okay, we're live again. So now everyone has to join this live stream.
Jeez.
I'm praying that this works. So I have to do an invite and send it to everybody. Oh my gosh. Okay, so I'm sending this new invite.
Well, there are going to be people watching this, we assume.
So we're still live. I have to click off the screen for a minute. So just here we go. So copy the clipboard. So James, you do some of the talking.
Should I just repeat literally what I just did for people that are watching this? So here's what just happened. We did the whole three or four David Katz's colors.
I started a new broadcast.
We did.
No, I did.
We did our opening.
I'm on already.
We're okay. On.
I'm gonna send.
Seth's talking to David Katz, who always does our tech with all of the stars beforehand to make sure this sort of thing doesn't happen. And I actually heard Lea Salonga earlier and some other guests. And
talk about who's coming on.
So, all right. So, we'll do that. I don't want to do it by memory. So, today is Lea Salonga, cross fingers. Tonight is Kristin Chenoweth. Tomorrow, matinee, is Beetlejuice. Tomorrow night, we have.
Oh, my God, a new announcement.
This is a new announcement, Fun Home Reunion, with a very special surprise guest.
Yes, we have the entire original cast.
Can't tell you who that is, but stay tuned for that. Monday matinee is going to be Julie Halston, Charles Bush, and just because it's an eclectic mix, Iain Armitage from Young Sheldon. And then Monday night starts our TV reunions of Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday night. Monday night, we have the cast of Taxi. Tuesday night, cast of This Is Us. And yes, there'll be some cast members who are singing. And on Wednesday night, we have the cast of Frasier. Seth is sending these.
I think this is going to work. I think I sent it
to everyone. Apparently, Julie came down and said, I can hear, but we can actually hear anything. So that's what's going on. I hope it isn't because it's like one of those things we moved the piano because we thought the lighting would be better. It's just a weird.
That's, oh, weird, hey, look. One, two, three.
Dr. LaBook.
Better?
Yay!
You don't have, you're hearing me. I'm screwing with you. I can talk fun. Sorry.
That stressed me the hell out. So, Dr. LaPook, we love your piece yesterday on CBS about the antibiotics. For people that missed it, can you tell everybody what that was?
Yeah, this is, you know, some good news. This is a technique that was used back in 1918 in the flu pandemic of 1918. They took the blood of people who recovered, and that blood has protective antibodies that come with immunity. And they gave it to people who were sick, and it seemed to help. It was used a little bit with Ebola, and now they're starting a big trial in the United States, including at Mount Sinai, where they've developed an antibody test to see if you have evidence of immunity. We're not talking about the nasal or throat swab that looks for active virus. That's the PCR. We're talking about a blood test available in a few hours. It says, you have antibodies. Looks like you're exposed. You probably, probably are immune. We need to find that out. Probably protected. So those kind of people, first of all, they might consider going back to work to the front lines. So there's that friction between, do you save the economy? Do you save the public health system? You can do both. But also, you'll know, we all want to know if we've been infected or we had no symptoms or mild symptoms a month ago, 2 months ago, wouldn't that be nice? And then that's going to find the people who might have antibodies in their blood, and they're going to be used in a trial for people who are hospitalized now with very sick COVID-19. So psyched about that, really, really excited. I think it's gonna get ramped up. And tomorrow morning, everybody should watch CBS Sunday Morning, which is a great show. Rand Morrison's a genius producer, executive producer. That he's having me at the very beginning of each one of these shows for the last month give a straight to camera spiel about the latest. And tomorrow, I already pre-taped, it's all about the antibody test and why we have to really get that out there widely. It's gonna be really big. We'll be able to find out that community spread, how wide is it throughout the country? Let's get our arms around this. So good news.
Also, by the way, Lea Salonga is back, which is also good news. Now, James, do we have any questions we need to ask?
Well, this was an interesting question we got. I don't know if you can answer this, but this is from Lynn. What quality thermometers can we use at home, you know, that you would recommend for an accurate reading? I don't know if you have an answer, but I just thought I'd throw it at you.
I do not have an answer to that. You know, I think if it's a good one under the tongue, the thing about under the tongue is, you know, you can't have had a cold drink. You have to really get a seal. The ear is good. you know, the most accurate ones are the rectal ones, but most people don't want to do that. I know.
Right.
Can I say something that's a little bit, but I want to get it out there. I think we're grown-ups here.
Yeah, so we'll take ourselves off screen so you don't see my facial reaction.
Okay. So it turns out that the virus is, you know, we know it's in the respiratory secretions. Even after that, it can also be in the stool. So the virus can be in the stool. So when you go to the bathroom, you have to really make sure that you wash your hands carefully afterwards. And you have to assume that that hand that you used could have some virus on it. So be very careful. You don't want to touch the faucet first. Use the other hand. I know this is so granular, but I think it's important. The problem is that if you touch the faucet and contaminate it, you're okay if you've already had the COVID. You're not going to infect yourself. But somebody else who touches that faucet could get it and then touch their hand to their mouth and nose. I know it's kind of icky to hear that. I really think it's important. So there you have it.
And we're back. Okay.
You can't say that for hand washing.
Yeah. Hand washing is the name of the game, folks. The number of times that somebody's going to sneeze right in your face, how often has that ever happened in your life? It's more likely that a droplet, somebody sneezes or cough, a droplet is somewhere, you put your hand on it, and then we all touch our mouth, nose, or eyes. We know that the nasolacrimal duct, there's a connection from the eye, the nose, back of the throat. You have eye drops, and yet you taste it, well, it goes down. So you got to keep your hands under your chin. I'm working on not biting my fingernails, which I've done since I was a kid, or my cuticles. I'm doing really well at that, really. I'm doing much better. And you just have to practice it. Put the bandana on, not so much even to protect you from the virus, but to stop you from training you to not touch your face. We all do it, right? We all do it.
We have one more question from Adam J., a.k.a. Call Me Adam, who's an online person. I live in Manhattan. My family lives in Atlanta. They're wanting me to come back to Atlanta to ride out this pandemic. Is it better for me to stay in my tiny New York City apartment or head down to Atlanta?
That's a great question.
So the advice now that we're hearing from our public health figures is if you're going to leave one of these areas and go to somewhere else, the last thing we want is for the epicenter people to then spread it elsewhere. So if you do decide to leave New York, you've got to self-quarantine for 14 days. Make sure you're not incubating it. That means you're not in touch with anybody else there. You're really doing it for real. I spoke to somebody who's up in Rhode Island today. He told me, I haven't confirmed this, but they're sending the National Guard to check to make sure that people stay. They're checking license plates to see if you're from New York and following up on that. Do they know your contacts? Things like that. So I think we're getting to the point where people are going to get a little scared about you're hearing quarantine orders and stuff. I heard that was mentioned. Governor Cuomo clarified it this morning, said, look, he doesn't see having an order where people can't leave their homes. But, you know, it's sort of like what happened in New Rochelle where they said shelter in place and just try to stay there. But anyway, there's a lot of mixed information coming now. We'll just have to wait and see.
But you're basically saying if you're going to go to Atlanta to be with your family in a nice house, quarantine yourself in that house for 14 days so you don't spread it.
Without exposure to her dear family and friends in Atlanta.
Right.
It's the last thing you want to do.
Okay, well, I love it. Dr. LaPook, you're coming back tonight for a Kristin Chenoweth. Now, by the way, Kristin wears full ball gowns, as you know.
Do you have a tuxedo or a jacket?
Yeah, you got to kind of up it a little bit for tonight.
I have to up it tonight? All right. Okay, challenge. You know, you're throwing. All right. Okay.
Off the shoulder. All right, we're going to see you soon.
All right, we'll see you. Bye. Thanks,
Dr. LaPook. Okay, now we're going to pray that our Manila connection works. This has never happened before. Please welcome back the lovely and audible Ms. Lea Salonga. Yay!
Oh, great!
Yay!
I'm so
happy. By the way, we're getting some comments, Lea Salonga. I don't know. Is this what's the word? Another language?
No. It's just a Filipino way of saying hi, everyone. It's hi, everyone. Just read it, and then it'll make sense when you hear it.
Right.
Okay,
that's all it is. Don't worry. Yeah. Chill lang kayo, which means everybody just chill. That's all. You're gonna get. I think you're gonna get comments in both languages.
I love it.
It should be fun. And if there's anything not so nice, I just won't translate. But I don't think we're gonna get anything.
No, people have been so great.
Yeah, we're not gonna get anything crazy. I don't think.
So, Lea Salonga, did you set your alarm for 1 a.m.
Yeah.
Or are you pulling an all-nighter? Which one?
I don't sleep. I mean, I normally go to bed at like 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. So this is normally when I'm up. And my daughter is as much of a night owl as I am. So she's in the kitchen playing video games, I think. And, Yeah, because she doesn't have school. She's officially on summer break. But yeah, I mean, she went on a school trip and then they announced the quarantine here in the Philippines. And so she's like, well, I guess I'm not going to school. She was actually quite thrilled. So she's perfectly happy to be at home, just gaming and live streaming with her friends, just being a kid.
How old is she?
She's 13 and almost as tall as me, which is not really saying very much.
So how is it in the Philippines? We haven't heard much going on down there.
We've hit over 1,000 confirmed cases of COVID-19 here. There have been quite a few recoveries, which is great, but there have also been quite a few deaths, unfortunately. I know one person, an acquaintance, who was a fashion designer here in the Philippines. So on Facebook, there have been tributes to him. And he was lovely. His son was a classmate of my daughter when they were in kindergarten until about the third grade. So it wasn't like somebody distant. It was somebody that we would see on Parents' Day and who would, you know, whipping out their cameras, taking video of the kids when they were on stage doing presentations in school. But I think his partner is okay. I think that he and his partner both got it. So I think he has passed away, but the partner I think is still fighting. So that's, I'm just hoping and praying that he comes through. They have a 13-year-old son. So it's one of those things. It's dicey and it's tough, but you know, everybody's, you know, finding efforts to, entertain other people. There have been, like, there's a video that just came out, like a whole bunch of theater people sang this Filipino song of hope. There's another one coming out tomorrow here, or actually in about 10 hours here in Manila, which is a bunch of stars from one of the networks here that The Voice is on. And then there's one where it's like a whole bunch of artists, just singers from everywhere, just coming together to sing a song saying we will heal as one. So that's just come out. So I think there's been so many efforts by a lot of performing artists, a lot of singers, a lot of recording people, just finding ways to be creative and putting efforts out there and raising funds and trying to raise money for freelance artists who are out of work, for people that are less fortunate. A bunch of us make messages for frontliners, the doctors, the nurses, the medical professionals, everybody who's in the hospitals, just fighting out this war. Yeah, so it's not the happiest of days anywhere, but there are rays of sunshine if you know where to look. Right. And I think there are a lot of artists that are trying to stay creative, and a lot of singers that are just singing regardless of how bad these times are. And I haven't gotten cabin fever yet. I'm quite happy being at home.
May I ask your signature question?
Yeah, the signature question is, what are you and your family doing to stay healthy?
Well, besides staying at home and just, you know, there's one designated person to go out and get the groceries, and that's my husband, you know, caveman of the house, going out to forage for supplies. So he's the one that does it consistently. I prefer to just stay at home, take our vitamins every day, take our probiotics every day, try to eat healthy food, get as much sleep as possible.
Really?
So whatever time I end up falling asleep, it's like 10 hours after that, that's when I wake up.
Oh, okay.
So I know that a couple of my friends in Manila are awake and they're watching this broadcast. And they've just been waiting for the stream to happen. So yeah, you guys are being watched like by people halfway around the world.
Yeah, we've been getting comments. Cool. We started this, Lea, from the Philippines. It's been really amazing.
You got this. What's that?
Oh yeah, okay. Somebody just put a comment out. Wala pa yan tulog. It means she has not had any sleep yet.
All right, so you said you're gonna give us a song to begin with. What do you got, Miss Salonga?
I've got, I'll give you a choice. I've got a couple here prepared.
Oh, okay.
So I have Story of My Life by One Direction. I also have Somewhere from West Side Story. So which one would you like?
Let's begin with Story of My Life. Okay. We'll get young people in with the one direction, and then old people at the end.
Good luck. I've been singing consistently, but not on stage. Here we go. Written in these walls are the stories that I can't explain. I leave my heart open, but it stays right here empty for days. She told me in the morning she don't feel the same about us in her bones. Seems to me when I die, these words will be written on my stone. And I'll be gone, gone tonight. The ground beneath my feet is burning bright. The way that I've been holding on so tight, with nothing in between. The story of my life, I take her home. I drive all night to keep her warm, and time is frozen. The story of my life, I give her hope. I spend her love until she's broke inside. The story of my life. These walls are the colors that I can't change. Leave my heart open, but it stays right here in its cage. I know that in the morning I will see a simple light upon a hill. And though I am broken, my heart is untamed. Still, and I'll be gone, gone tonight. The fire beneath my feet is burning bright. The way that I've been holding on so tight, with nothing in between. The story of my life, I take her home. I drive all night to keep her warm, and time is frozen. The story of my life, I give her hope. I spend her love until she's broke inside. The story of my life, and I've been waiting for this time to come around. But baby, running after you is like chasing the clouds. The story of my life, I take her home. I drive all night to keep her warm, and time is frozen. The story of my life, I give her hope. I spend her love until she's broken inside. The story of my life, the story of my life, the story of my
Okay. Someone has where was it?
That was beautiful, Lea.
It was so beautiful. Hold on.
Thank you.
Basically, someone said, how can she sound so amazing without sleeping? And I guess we have the same medical question. What's up with that? How's it possible?
I had to warm up before doing this. And I did get my sleep. I got my sleep and I woke up like 2 in the afternoon. So I had a good night's sleep. Yeah. This is... Yeah, so I've actually slept, you guys.
How about this?
Parang hinaharaan ako ni, that's a misspelling. Parang hinaharaan ako, oops, ni Miss Lea.
What does that mean?
Harana is kind of a, You know how back in those old courtship days where men would sing to their beloveds who are like at the window looking at, kind of, so it's like she's singing for me, she's singing to me. It's like she's, you know, just right outside my window singing to me. That's kind of like that.
Okay.
Oh, Dr. LaPook has a very important comment. Leon, oh. I Maganda, Lea.
Oh, that just means beautiful.
Oh. What?
That's a word.
We're the idiot.
So, Dr. LaPook, the crazy thing and what I'm obsessed with is that you were a medical student, right? When you tried
to. Was. Not a medical student. No, I was in my freshman year in university and I was in pre-med. And before my sophomore year began, I auditioned for Miss Saigon. Wow. So yeah,
in Manila.
Yeah, I was 17 years old. I was still in my freshman year in college and I was going to be a doctor. That I kind of had my sights on a medical career. So listening to the words of Dr. LaPook wasn't, you know, I wasn't squeamish when he was talking about all that he was talking about.
Well, let me ask you something. Yeah. Did you wanted to be a doctor? Is that because you have Jewish and or Asian parents? Which one?
Asian, clearly. There we go. I guess it was just something I was always kind of interested in. I loved biology when I was in high school. My teacher was really inspiring and she was fantastic. So I'm like, you know what? I'll give this a shot. But I don't think that, not anymore. I think I'm enjoying this way too much.
But didn't you, like, if that audition hadn't been in Manila, would you have not, have a dream of flying to Broadway?
Nope, I don't think so. So I guess it was a stroke of luck that those auditions were in Manila. And there were actually people from Hong Kong that flew in to audition in Manila as well. So I think there were, but they were also Filipino. I can't remember who they were, but yeah, there were a couple of people that flew in to audition for Miss Saigon.
But Lea, Les Mis came out before Miss Saigon. So had you heard that music at all? Like, did you know?
I only started listening to Les Mis to prepare for the audition for Miss Saigon. And once I started listening to that cast album, I got real obsessed really fast.
Aww.
I think like a lot of people, And so I think to this day, I can probably sing most of the 3-hour and 15-minute version of the show, which to me, it is superior to the 3-hour version. And
no, I did
Seth, the original. Please back me up on this.
No, I did the original 3:15. I did that. And then they cut the 15 minutes to save money in overtime. I agree with you. Still devastating.
The 3:15 version. So anybody who saw, and I've done both. I've done both versions. I've done the 3-hour one as Fontaine, the 3:15 as Eponine. And I'm like, I would be backstage and I'd be like,
no, but the shorter version is literally like, on my own. Like, it's so short. It's so like, what happened to the song?
I know.
The hell? Okay, so wait. I remember you told me you were at the audition and was it you didn't have your music? Something with a Whitney song happened.
Yes. So after I'd sung on my own, the director looks at me and he asks me if I had another song prepared. I said I didn't, but I told him that, I know The Greatest Love of All. And so Claude Michel said, go ahead and sing it, but sing it your way. I mean, mm-hmm. Don't sing it the way Whitney does it, meaning sing it like you. We need to hear how you do it. So I thought that I was gonna have to do it a cappella, and then so I went to the pianist to ask him if he knew the song and if he could play it for me. And then on top of the piano, on the upright, somebody had left behind from their audition, their sheet music. And it was The Greatest Love of All. It was like, I'm not joking. And I still remember which singer it was that left it there. And so I'm like, and because I knew her voice type, I knew it wasn't gonna be too high or too crazy. It was not gonna be in the Whitney key. So I'm like, if this isn't the key I think it is, this could very well be mine. So I gave it to the pianist. Right. And I'm like, play that, just play that. And then I went back to the X, and then I'm like praying, dear God, please don't let this be so high. And then once he started playing it, I was like, yes, it was an alto that sang this. So I started singing it, and I just enjoyed it. So it was like, okay.
And then when they
this is gonna be good.
They flew you to London for the callback, right?
They flew me to London for, they called it final assessments, whatever that means.
Right.
So I guess that was my final callback. And I was on stage at Theatre Royal Drury Lane. That's where I first met Simon Bowman. And I also got to meet Frances Ruffell. I think she was singing the Ellen part as well for that. I don't know if she was auditioning or if it was just one of those things, but I knew that I was singing with her. I sang with Keith Burns, who was offered the role of Tui on the spot. Like right after we sang together, he went off the stage, and then I just saw him like jumping up and down. I'm like, I guess somebody's employed. So yeah. And he was, I think, in Les Mis at the time, or had just left it. There was a whole bunch of Les Mis people that started in Miss Saigon. Yeah.
And tell everybody the crazy way you found out that you got it.
Well, first of all, they're like, Cameron calls me into his office with my mom and Nick Heitner. And all they said was, we cast you in the show, but we don't know what role you're playing. Never mind that throughout this whole audition, I'm only auditioning for one role, y'all. So I'm like, okay. And whatever. If I'm in the ensemble, then my mom said, if you got ensemble, then you know what? I would have told you to just stay in school. I'm like, all right, obviously that didn't happen. So we then went back to Manila. And then during this final assessment time, there was also a photo shoot where I had my hair kind of done in a bun, and we were, you know, dressed up with like kind of Nehru collars or Chinese collared kind of thing. And then I see my face on like the Sunday supplement of the Daily Mail. I'm like, well, I guess I got the part. So it's kind of crazy.
You really,
I mean, that was confirmation that I had gotten the part. It's not like one of those, yeah. And then I think there were telexes that were coming into, because my dad brought in a telex machine for us to use, I guess from his office or something. And then we were getting the telexes, and there were like offers that were coming in as to how many shows I would be doing a week. And
it was just a crazy time.
It was just nuts. I just remembered all being knucking futs. That's all I remember. It was crazy. It was a crazy time.
How old were you? You were 17?
I was 17. I was 17. And I turned 18 the following February. And then the following June, or beginning of July, that's when I headed off to the UK, I think. I may be getting my dates mixed up, but I do remember. I do remember it was the summer, and it was a really lovely summer.
Oh my God. Okay, so listen, Dr. John LaPook keeps saying we have to keep in touch with our friends during the social distancing.
Yes.
Isolating. So take the onus off of you keeping in touch with your friends. We brought your own friend to say hi. Hi, Alex.
Hi.
Oh my gosh, look at you.
Look at you, touch your hair even more.
No, actually, I haven't cut it in like the last, I don't know, month? Like since isolation and 2 weeks prior, because I was in the hospital.
How are you?
I had like bad tonsillitis. So,
oh God.
Yes.
Yeah. Wait,
like the whole company on Zoom or something.
Yeah.
That'll be like real loud.
Yeah.
Alex is in New York right now. Yes. Alex, would you share with us the Lea Salonga story that maybe her fans?
Oh God.
Uh-oh. Hi, Lea.
What story is this?
Oh my goodness. I think the funniest story is when Lea quite literally asked Norm to take a photo of her and a guest after the show once. And he was so taken aback. And she just, without even thinking, said, do you have a Tony?
Sorry.
Fair.
Valid.
Fair. Totally fair, but I do love Norm.
We all love Norm, but it was just so funny. Like, and the room didn't know whether to like die or just start laughing.
So, Alex Newell, I'm going to bring you back for a full show where you're going to actually perform. I just need to show you this clip.
Oh my God.
I'm so obsessed with your placement. Okay, so hold on. And we're going to talk about it. What I want you guys to just notice is that when he gets to the high note, it's not even vibrato, it's the most amazing, it's like a spin. It's so brilliantly placed. Listen to this. The spin, listen to that again. The spin is incredible. One more time, I'm upset. What does that feel like in your face?
I don't know. Trying to push out as much of a mix as at 7 o'clock in the morning that will come out.
That was not fun to get up that early.
No, it wasn't.
It was worth it though to meet Ralph Macchio that morning.
It was.
We
it
all met him.
And Will and Willie Billy
Billy Gay.
Bill, William Zabka.
Oh yes.
Yes.
Hey, where are you right now? It looks a little barren back you. Can you show us a little bit of your apartment?
This is just my apartment. This is my dining room.
Well, okay.
That's it. That's literally it. I just moved in. There's my table. It used to say life up there, but the previous owners took it away and I was very upset. It was like life and lights. But no, I'm just in my little two bed, two bath in Harlem.
Wow.
By myself.
You fancy.
Thank you. Okay, miss, I would like to walk from my apartment to the theater.
Hey, that was fantastic.
It was
the best. Best commute ever.
Okay, Alex, I'm fading out on you because you're going to come back and do a real show with me. Oh, yeah, wait a minute.
Wait a minute. Alex, asked you earlier, did you find a song?
Yeah,
you
said, oh, God, I'll sing. I don't care.
We were going to
manipulate you.
Come on, you want a song?
Oh, my goodness. Should I sing something about being beautiful, like too beautiful for words?
Whatever that
is. Oh, whatever you like.
Come on. Wait, I'll do that. But I'm going to sing because you're the beautiful goddess of love.
Yes.
And I would never sing human heart in front of you. Because that just seems redundant. Hold on. Let me see if I can find it. There it is.
Okay, go for it. Go.
I've always been the kind of gal that had a lot to say. I says the things that's on my mind, too dumb to shy away. But you hushed my mouth and stilled me with a song I've never heard. I guess that means that you are just too beautiful for words. I've seen this life from high and low and all that's in between. I've danced with dudes, groomed with camps, been courted like a queen. But when I see what's in your heart, all the rest is blurred. The grace you bring into this world's too beautiful for words. You hide your head under your wing, just like a little bird. Oh, don't you see that you are just too beautiful for words. Mm-hmm, you're too beautiful.
That was it.
Oh, diva.
Hi, George.
I'm okay.
I would like to go to sleep now.
Look at us side by side. Oh,
goodness, she's almost taller than you.
Almost. Not yet.
Alex, that was so beautiful.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Diva.
I'm trying to be an actor only again, everybody, not a singer.
You know what? Not having
it. Shut up.
Exactly.
Just shut up.
Silence. Okay, so Alex, you're going to come back for a full show. We love you. You're so talented.
Bye. I love you guys. Thank you so much.
Okay, so by the way, hi. Well, let me just look at the comments.
I don't know. There you go. Oh, there you go. Okay.
This is for you or Alex. So there you go.
I don't know. I think it applies.
Right. It's gender bent everywhere.
What about that? What is
now? What does this mean? It better be nice.
Nakakahawa yung tawa mo, Miss Lea. It makes me happy too. Oh, your laugh is so contagious, Miss Lea. It makes me happy.
I love it. Hold on. One more. Nicole. Wait.
Okay.
Hold on. Where is
this one right here, Seth?
Keep
getting comments here. There you go.
Mahal na mahal ka namin, babes. Oh, we love you very much.
Aw. Very sweet.
And then they're so asking, sweet.
Any duet?
Nope, not today.
Yes.
not like today.
You. Like yourself.
And she's back. She's back to her video game in the kitchen right now.
So Miss Lea,
I wanted her to see Alex.
You got to keep in touch with your friends. And yet again, we've got to keep you in touch with your friends. So you may know this person, Jose Llana.
Oh. What's up, girl?
Oh, I'm loving this.
How are you?
This is too good.
You made my life when you sang the story of my life, because that's like.
I can't hear you.
Oh, no, you can't hear me?
Oh, I can hear it. I can hear him. Hold on.
I can't hear him.
Hear me. I'm.
Test. Talk.
I can't.
That is so weird. I will translate for Jose. You made my life.
So if you can, yeah.
Because
he said you made my life, and you sang story of my life, and there it is on his on his playlist. For those of you who don't know what Jose did with Miss Thing, here they are making love.
Oh my God, we're such babies in that photo.
Oh my God. Okay, Jose, Llana. Okay, how come like
I can hear you.
We can hear you.
How
too.
Come Alex Newell's apartment was like darkness and you're literally in a spa? Where are you? Like,
well, I'm in my bedroom that my husband during the day is now his office because he's working from home now. So I'm at his desk, and then I'm sequestered in our living room in there. So I'm now sitting at this lovely desk with the window. So.
The natural light is fabulous. All right, so obviously Lea can't hear you, so this visit is a bust. But we're not hearing you. So
try again. Maybe.
Yeah. Maybe. Wait, hold on. Let me.
I can hear Alex. I don't know why I can't hear Jose though.
Hold on.
Lea, can you hear me?
You can try to log on one more time if you want.
Like, yeah, if you want, try to log on.
Like, leave the studio, then come back.
Yeah, maybe he just wants to get out and get back in. All right, there it is.
Oh.
I could hear him.
No, it was working. Anywho, Lea Salonga,
get people, back in.
Well, hold on.
He's got to come back.
How do you know Jose?
Yeah.
We worked together in Flower Drum Song, first at the Mark Taper Forum, and then on Broadway. So I think this picture was taken from the Broadway production because I'm wearing a wig. I wasn't wearing a wig in the taper. But yeah, those are fabulous costumes by the amazing Greg Barnes.
Now they're working.
In the background, but yes.
Oh!
There we go. Technology in our favor. Hooray.
So Jose, do you have a little story about Lea that not maybe everybody knows?
God.
How about my final callback for Flower Drum Song?
Oh, yes.
So, I mean, to give you guys perspective, like here, from my perspective, I was like this young guy who had just done his first show on Broadway, and I get a callback to like maybe being a show with like one of my idols as a, you know, growing up, I had her small voice record growing up as a kid, you know. And so it was one of the things where I was probably just, I was going on 100% nerves and just fear and like, let's just do it. And I sang, and there she was, like she was at my final callback and she stands there and then she reads with me. And during, I think it was Like a God, right? I think at the end of Like a God, I sing this high note and then I just grab her shoulders and plant this massive kiss on Lea. That I don't normally do to like readers and like, you know, maybe the woman that you're gonna maybe be playing opposite, but I'm like, I went with it. And like, I hope I got the job. But yeah, so I planted a massive kiss on Lea before we really got to know each other.
But hold on. I just realized something. Jose, speaking of amazing stories, please tell Lea Salonga about your illegal act at your first big Broadway audition.
So I
what did you
I was
do?
Well, I was a freshman in college when they were auditioning for The King and I was not equity. So I just kind of naively was told that if you go to an EPA, they'll wait, you can wait all day and they'll see you at the end of the day. I went, and midway through the day, they called someone's name for his appointment, and no one was there. So I raised my hand and I kind of just walked into the room and sung the song. And they were like, you're going to get a call back. And they're like writing on this guy's resume with a face down on the table. And I'm like, that's not me. I'm a freshman in college, and I'm like almost starting to cry. I'm like, I just was here for the experience. Please don't call the police.
I literally thought you could get arrested. It was just so sweet.
I was like you. I was like 17. I was 18 when I auditioned for that. So I was like, I didn't know anything, and I thought I already been impersonating somebody. Well, got the job. So it's
fine. Well, you got the gig.
Got the gig.
So you know what? By any means necessary, as we say.
That's right.
All right, Jose, you're going to come back and sing another time. Maybe we'll do a Here Lies Love reunion.
Ah.
Ooh.
Yeah.
We went on last week, so I'll be in touch as we say.
All right. Later. So love you, sweetie. And Ingaka over there in the Philippines.
Yeah,
so please
absolutely.
Give Marmela.
You guys too, please.
Okay. Please see you online. I see you on social media every day, so I'll see you soon.
By the way, Jose, I wish I had come in that way, because when you did that Filipino tour, Jose Llana. I remember when they did that tour. I remember everything. Okay, bye.
All right, bye.
I'm so glad that worked, that he was able to come back.
Yay.
So, Lea, if you were asking for any Aladdin stories you have, do you have any, when you got the gig or recording session, what?
Oh, well, hang on. Let me look at this first. Kailan ka po magtatayo ng Hopia Factory? It's like, this one has a story to go behind it, but it just means when are you going to build a hopia? It's like a Chinese bean cake kind of a thing. Hopia is kind of a slang term for hope, meaning there are a bunch of fans of mine from Manila who are hoping that I make another movie with one of the like most amazing leading men here. He and I have done two films together, and I think people are hoping for a third. So that's not happened yet. So people are, yeah, so hope, yeah. So people are like hoping for that to happen. Not gonna happen. Mrs. Chen, nakakahawa. Yeah, contagious. Nakakawala ng takot sa nangyayari ngayon. Your laughter is contagious, and it helps to take away the fear from what's happening today. That's a really sweet comment. Oh, nice. But Aladdin stories, I mean, it was just such a, okay, my audition story for that. Audition stories are always so interesting. Previous to my auditioning for Aladdin, I was just hearing about this new Disney movie from a lot of the women in the building, that a lot of them had gone in for it. And so I would hear conversations in hallways and things, whispered stuff like, have you gone in for that Disney movie yet? And somebody would say, yeah, I already went in and I sang for it. And I'm like, I have no idea what any of them is talking about. And then after one performance of Saigon, I went to the call board because somebody said, you have a message. Somebody left you something at the call board. So I went and I go get it. And it was from the casting director of Aladdin, Albert Tavares. And I opened the note and it said something to the effect of, we've been looking for you. Would you please give me a call? We want you to come in to sing for this new Disney movie. So I'm like, I guess that's the one everybody's been talking about. So I give him a call and I go in to audition, and I'm not looking particularly cute. Thank goodness they did not have to judge me based on my appearance, which is nice. When I met Alan Menken and Tim Rice and everybody else on that creative team on the panel, all of them were like, okay, we're gonna bow our heads down. We're gonna look down. Don't take offense, because we don't need to see you. We just need to hear your voice. So I had prepared Part of Your World from The Little Mermaid. Mm-hmm. And I went in and I sang it. And then after that, Alan got up and went to the piano and then started playing Part of Your World a semitone up. And then he kept on going. I guess he just needed to see how high my voice could go. And then that was it. The next thing I knew, I was called in, not for a callback, but to record a demo for A Whole New World. And we recorded it with yeah, I was just in a little studio. David Friedman was there. And then the next thing after that was with a full blown orchestra at Sony, at the Sony Paramount Studios in the city. And I was there pretty much the whole day. I was allowed to take the night off the night before. I was still in Miss Saigon. And the recording was, I think, a few days before my 21st birthday. So that was that was a really sweet birthday gift. Yeah. And then the movie was released that Thanksgiving.
And then
so it was really quick. It was really quick. I didn't have to wait for like 2 or 3 years.
But hold on. But how crazy, though, that you were in such a worldwide hit, but you could go elsewhere around the world and they wouldn't necessarily know who you were. Did they know who you were?
Right.
How did that work, being in an animated movie?
You're pretty much anonymous.
Yeah.
And it's very strange. It's real strange seeing your what the animation looks like, but knowing that it's your voice.
Right.
It was a little weird to see it the first time. And then when Mulan came out and I had to see that, it was like, okay, I get it. And it didn't feel, Brad Kane had the best word for it, disembodied. Because it's like a whole other being possessing your voice. It was like the Little Mermaid, where it's like a totally different person with Ariel's voice. So it was like, it was that. That's how it felt. I guess all of us kind of felt like Ariel. Like, that. Why is my voice in that other person?
They took your voice. And of course, everyone is obsessed with Mulan. Now for Mulan, you got to do the dialogue as well, right?
No, that was Ming-Na Wen who did that. I only got to sing it.
What was that any different from doing Aladdin? Did you know better?
No, it was the same. For Aladdin, they had already recorded all of Princess Jasmine's stuff. And then creatively, they decided, okay, these two need to sing a song together. Scott Weinger, who played Aladdin speaking, doesn't sing. And neither does Linda Larkin, who was Jasmine speaking. She didn't sing either. So they had to hire Brad Kane and myself to sing for these two characters. So, yeah.
Wow.
That's pretty cool. Weird.
And what about the Oscars? How terrifying?
Not as terrifying as people might think. Huh. We were lucky because of a lot of the noise that was happening with a lot of the technical stuff that was going on with, you know, there was fire breathers and snakes and a forklift truck that had to kind of be the magic carpet, it would get picked up by microphones. So there was no way we could actually sing live. So we had to sing to a pre-record, which we had done, I think, a few days earlier, in case, as in a lot of award shows. So we didn't have a choice. We had to sing to a track.
Oh, so no stress. All right, comments.
No stress.
Look at this comment. This is really touching. My mom is a doctor facing 24/7 shifts because of COVID-19, but every time she hears you sing, her stress just goes away.
Oh, that's so sweet.
Oh, very sweet.
That is so lovely. And I guess that that's why the singers and the artists, that's why we do what we do at this time. It might not seem like a lot, but if it helps somebody, if it helps a frontliner get through the day or even through an hour of a shift, then we've done some good. I mean, I don't think we're gonna change the world necessarily, but if we provide a little bit of comfort for someone, a little bit of a mental, like a mental break, just to kind of, you know, kind of reset the mind, if we're able to do that, that's fantastic. So there's actually been a series of these online stay at home concerts here in the Philippines that a lot of us have been doing via Facebook Live. Mine is actually coming up on April the 2nd.
Ooh.
And you guys will be able to see it as well. So great. Everybody's kind of, you know, streaming it from their homes. There have been like the front men of bands who do it, a lot of soloists. It's being spearheaded by one of our national artists. His name is Ryan Kayabyab. And also one of our foremost songwriters, Trina Belamide. And so they kind of did a call to action for a whole bunch of us. And so we all said yes. And so now my slot is for the beginning of April. They asked if I wanted to do April 1 or April 2. And I'm like, I don't like April Fool's Day. And I just, no. So well, I'll do mine on the second, please. And please and thank you. When I have more details, then I'll obviously posting on social media. And
yeah, everyone's going to want to watch.
On the second, that's when I'm doing mine.
Well, Lea, your music hasn't just been lifting spirits. It's also been raising money for the Actors Fund. So I wanted to read a few before you
Give
us the song. These have come in during the show
this
today
is just
with
a
you.
Smattering, by the way. We just get kind of like eight every
Yeah, the Actors Fund sends
a lot more than this come in.
So Andre from New Jersey, thank you for donating $100. Susan from Georgia, $25. Gary from Florida donated $100. Don from New Jersey, $25. Bonnie from Illinois, $10.
Midwest.
That's right.
Midwest.
Bonnie. Stephen from Florida, $150. And Jeff from Texas, $50. Thank you so much.
That is amazing. Thank you so much.
And look at this.
Artists, ushers.
That's right.
People that work in the theater and the entertainment industry, they're all going to be so thankful. Every little bit is helpful.
We got this photo of nurses taking a break from their shift to watch Stars in the House. That's them.
Oh!
Isn't that nice, though?
Mental break on our lunch break. Yay!
It makes a difference. Okay, so speaking of your amazing voice, I know that you sound best at 3 a.m. So we'd love you to do a song before you
depart. Yes.
Absolutely. I've got another track, so hopefully I don't mess this up. Mm-hmm. Haven't sung this in a while. Let me just make sure everything is working.
Okay, the breath control.
The sustain.
The breath control, the spin. Okay, Jose's loving it. Okay, everybody's amazing. Basically, tonight, so you're going to stay up for tonight's show and come visit again, Lea. We're at 8 a.m. in the morning your time. We have Kristin Chenoweth. And so many surprise guests. Your head's going to come off. Dr. LaPook, like I said, you got to get dressed up for tonight's show.
That's right.
Jose Llana, you featured in a different spa this time. We'll find out.
That's right. Beautiful. With our dogs, all we have to do is just point.
There's our sweet. We always reveal our doggies at the end.
The dogs in the hashtag.
All right, so guys, don't forget to follow the new at Stars in the House and Instagram everywhere. Right. Lea Salonga, your Facebook concert is going to be
April 2nd.
Yeah. I still don't know the time, but it's April the 2nd at a somewhat decent hour for the New Yorkers.
Okay.
Oh, that's
in the morning for you guys. Yeah.
Okay.
We'll be watching. All right, bye, everybody. See you tonight.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye.
Thank you. And broadcast and.